was experiencing the natural world was nothing compared to the great harvest he would reap in the spirit world as he became a fisher of men. So then it was another incident recorded in John 21. The disciples had fished all night and caught nothing again. At Christ's command, they cast in the net, and once again, it was filled with fish, but this time was different than the first. And the difference was the net didn't break. Just as many fish, if not more, but the net did not break. John 21:11 tells us, Simon Peter went up and drew the net to land full of great fish and 153. And for all there were so many, yet was not the net broken. These two events eventually happened in the natural world, but they were parallels of a great spiritual truth. The first time the net broke, but the second time it didn't. What was the difference? And I'm going through this, so it's kind of laying the foundation of, you know, what we're working with for the rest of the chapter. The first net was an example of the efforts of men. Peter was a fisherman by trade. He knew the natural methods and the traditions of fishermen. Through the broken net, Jesus showed him that the efforts of man cannot fulfill the vision and work of God. Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. When Peter realized the great work which God was calling him, he cried out. Okay. Well, when God tell you, what do you want you to do?
Tell him how you can't do it.
I'm just a simple man. Oh, yeah. I can't do it. You calling me? Little old me? Nah. Yeah. So I think most of us probably at some point had that the same response as Peter. Like, nah, I'm just a simple man. I can't do it. You might want to get a little older person. Yeah. Peter would become a fisher of men. The old network could not accommodate the great spiritual harvest. Peter would have to abandon the traditions of men. He must cross the line of separation between Jew and Gentile, because he was a devout Jew. He was a Jew. So God, like, no, you have to be a fisher of men. Yeah, Jew, Gentile, black, white.
That's
the next course coming up. Okay. Alright, jump down to the second paragraph on that scripture. The old network must be broken and he must become part of the new network. Same with us. Some of our old networks have to be broken because we're walking into something new. This is a new thing that you're doing. And some of the old stuff, as you walk this journey, it's going to either fall off or you're going to have to make it fall off. And one thing about God, his spirit, the Holy Spirit, will help you through all of it. Jesus did not come to destroy the old, but to fulfill it through the new. He did not destroy the law, but added new meaning to it. He did not abolish the blood sacrifice for sin, but fulfilled it through the shedding of his own blood for the remission of sin. Jesus warned about putting new wine in old skins. The old skins would not be able to hold the new wine. The challenge of the Great Commission cannot be accomplished with anything less than a new net in the spirit world. Do we agree? Yeah. All right. Some things we just can't do and that we used to do, and we're trying to minister to people. This is not my work.
And I think this is one of the reasons why I felt I needed to, you know, get some type of formal training, because I've been in the church, you know, I'm a PK, and I've been in the church, and I just go by, you know, what I learned from being in the church, instead of really,
you know,
what I'm supposed to be.
I agree. I grew up in church. I could do it with my eyes closed. I love church. Even as a teenager, I love church because all of my friends were in church. Everybody, I mean, I was in this church since I was a little girl, so we grew up together. So those were the people I hung out with. So I could do church in my sleep. Mm-hmm. Then I was 30-something, in my late 30s. I started having my aunt invited me to a prayer meeting, and it just opened my eyes to other, you know, other things, but I still had that church tradition down. So God was like, okay, she's getting it a little bit, but she needs a little bit more. So then he sent me here to Sanctuary of Living Waters, page 96. And oh my God, like, y'all don't understand. It was a shock to the system, because I came from Baptist. And, you know, Sanctuary is Pentecostal, so I was sitting in church like. But the word.
Really
everybody thought I was mean because I would sit just like this. Because, you know, but what she was preaching was so profound. The word that, you know, she was. Okay. The word that was I was hearing. It wasn't new to me, but it was different. It was different. And just the experiences I've had since I've been in this house I had to be here in order to experience the spiritual side. I had the word side.
Got that.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Chapter this, verse that. You know, got that. But that spiritual side, God had to wake up something in me. So he had to pull me out of something old that I could do in my sleep and put me in new wineskin, and I have not been the same.
And it's because where people just get hung up in that place, the Bible says that the word is spirit. It's spirit. So when you have a head knowledge, you know, when you've just been in, and yeah, you can clap and you can sing and all of that, but when that word, which is spirit, hits your spirit, it's something different. It's different. It's just not word. Okay? Because the Bible says that the demons, they know the word. Mm-hmm. They know Jesus. You know, and they tremble at it. But when you can just go in and out and do your own thing, you know the word, but when it doesn't transform your life,
yes,
then what did he say? Your traditions have made the word of God of none effect.
Yes.
No power to change. So, go ahead.
And one more example. I went back to my home church and you know, I still like some of the traditional stuff. And I remember this lady joined the church, a young girl, and you know, they asked you the three questions that they always ask you to be. And Jesus Christ, do you accept him as your Lord and Savior? I'm like, okay. And you could tell she was full. And I was like, and it was so much so that, you know, I wanted to cry. And so, okay. And I was like, okay, we're gonna give you the right hand. This is Deacon such and such, gonna be your ward leader. And that was it. Like, you all are going to pray for her or speak into her life? I left in tears. I'm like, I cannot believe it, because they just they did everything they were supposed to do.
Right here in the fellowship.
Yeah, they did. Yeah, you know, everybody walking around, you know, walking around. And it just disturbed me, because here's a lively soul that was crying out. And because you're so focused on your tradition, you didn't even recognize it. Mm-hmm. And if you did, you didn't attend to it.
Yeah.
So what if something had, you know, she could have been contemplating suicide? We have to have a discernment in the spirit. And this training here, we're gonna get there. We're already there. Bless the Lord. Where was that? Between the first and the second fishing trips, a new network had been created. The natural fishing incidents. No, we done.
No.
Okay. Were parallels of what had happened in the spirit world. This new page 96. Okay. This new spiritual network can accommodate the vision which Jesus gave, but to enter it, one must step from the old into the new. The old yoke must be broken. The old net must be destroyed in order for the new net to be held. So, name of this chapter again.
Good luck.
What is it?
Breaking the yoke.
All right. What's a yoke?
When I looked it up, a yoke is like either wood or iron, but it has two holes that you put around the animal's neck so they can work together. Am I right? And in that's how you get them to work together.
Something that holds you bondage.
It's a bondage?
Yeah. Do it have to be a bondage?
No.
Can it be a good thing?
Mm-hmm. It can be.
Yeah, your marriage vows are yokes.
Yeah.
You Jesus know, and it's just how you look at it.
Yeah. Jesus said his yoke is easy and his burden is light. So he had a yoke, but it was.
Depends on the yoke.
Yeah, it depends on the yoke.
So imagine, do you know what a yoke looked like?
Like an egg.
It's a. You know what it looks like? Have you ever seen men in chains?
Oh yeah, bound together,
handcuffs.
That's what a yoke is. So you can't move unless prisoner number 72893 moves. That's what that's why we have to be careful of who we're yoked to. Because wherever they go, you go.
So be not unequally yoked.
Yes. Because, you know, even in your marriage, like, you know, if you're single looking, you must be equally yoked. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm sorry about all my stories, but, you know, I was dating a guy and my Christian friend, he's like, Adrian, you know, I would tell him, oh, we did this and he's this and he's that. He's like, Adrian, you're not equally yoked. I'm like, you know, what do you mean? That, you know, I'm not better than him. That would make me better than him if I'm not equally yoked with him. You must be equally yoked. A few months later, that joker. Uh-huh. Whoo, Jesus. I won't tell the rest of the story, but I understood why you should be equally yoked. Really. It's so much easier when we do things God way. It's so much easier because he mapped it out. He know what we need, and he set up a plan for us that worked perfectly for us, and it works in our favor. But you know, we always say kicking against the fruit. Is that right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Exactly. You were used all over the ancient. I'm sorry, yokes. were used all over the ancient world to unite animals together to labor in the harvest field. They are still used for the purpose in many nations today. So, you know, you have two bulls or two mules or oxens, you know, yoked together to plow, and they have a plow, but a lot of machines do that stuff now, but there are still countries that still use those today. So in our key verse today, Jesus spoke of the yoke when he said, come unto me, all ye that are labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Can you imagine just being yoked with Jesus? Even if you go into bad territory, he will fight your battle. Though I walk through the valley of shadow death, I shall fear no evil because I'm yoked with Jesus. That's a good yoke. That's a good yoke. The vision he has given is of the harvest field. Today, the field represents 3 billion people who have never received the gospel message. And he tells us this challenge is easy and light. So imagine God tells you, okay, I need you to go to Indonesia. You don't know anything about Indonesia. Hopefully you read up on it. But he needs you to go and spread the gospel over there. But he is yoked with you. So you're not worried. You're not worried about the language barrier. I was talking to a coworker today, and he was talking about doing gold and silver. And she was saying, you know, I'll just, you know, go to Europe. I said, well, at least you can speak Spanish. She's Spanish. You can speak two languages. She said, you know, don't worry about it. She said, when you're engulfed in the language, and that's all you hear, you will pick it up real quick. So when Jesus throws you in there, he'll throw you in there, but you're engulfed in him. What he said about the vine. He's the vine, and we are in him. He's in us, and we're in him, so we don't have to worry. And that's that is what this is about. So when we are ministering abroad and afar, abroad and near, he's in us. So you don't necessarily have to go to Indonesia. You can go next door. Or in your own home and minister. The vision he gave us is one of the harvest fields. Today that field represents 3 billion people who have never heard the gospel. And he tells us his yoke is easy and light. That is exactly what he is saying. But the old network, the old yoke cannot accommodate the new vision or the vision. You cannot fulfill it yourself. You cannot do it through the efforts of man. I have to remind myself of that thought. Forever trying to help God out. You must become a part of a new network and be yoked together with him. Okay, and then there are yokes of bondage. Yokes of bondage. The yoke of sin. The yoke of self. And the yoke of man. Okay? Those are 3 yokes of bondage. The yoke of sin. The yoke of Egypt means the yoke of sin. You must have the yoke of sin broken in your life if you are to come under the yoke of Jesus. You can't be yoked to Jesus and sin. So it's something you have to let go. Turn your life around. Repent. And the Holy Spirit is there to guide us along the way. And then there's the bondage of self. Selfishness and pride are examples of the yoke of self. I'm on page 98. The yoke of man. The yoke of man can include the bondage of guilt, tradition, denomination, or impossible standards of behavior imposed by others. The threefold yoke of bondage of sin, self and man speaks of imposed labor, heaviness, and restlessness.
I highlight that for you heard saying.
So highlight the threefold yoke of bondage. Mm-hmm. You need to know those. Then there's the threefold yoke of God. Read me the 3 yokes of God. Just read that section.
Easy, light. The threefold yoke of God is easy, light, and restful.
Were you reading that section for me, or were you?
Oh, I thought you wanted us to read it as a group.
No, anybody. Go ahead. You're okay.
The yoke of God speaks of a united labor instead of imposed labor. It speaks of lightness instead of heaviness. It is a yoke of rest instead of restlessness. The threefold yoke of God is easy, light, and restful. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Matthew 11, verse 28-30.
Well, y'all gonna have that deep down in your spirit before night open. I think that's like the third or fourth time we've read that. Keep reading. Tisha, read the 3 steps to bridge the gap.
Jesus provided 3 steps to bridge the gap between the yoke of bondage and the yoke of God. It is the way out of the old to the moon. Come, you must willingly come to him. This destroys the yoke of sin. Take, you must take his yoke. In doing so, the yoke of man is destroyed. Learn. By learning of him, you destroy the yoke of self.
So, are we doing all three in this school? We're coming to him. The fact that you recognize that you want to learn more, you want more. So you're coming willingly to him. And you're going to need his yoke throughout the course, you know, just to keep coming, because just like anything, it gets a little hard sometimes. There are times you don't want to come, and you know, but grab a hold of his yoke, mm-hmm. and he will help you. It will destroy some of that self stuff. Mm-hmm. And of course, we are learning about him.
In evangelism, the people that you meet where they are burdened with sin. Okay, sin is heavy. Sin is a burden. It's not easy at all. And so being able, first, you have to have an understanding of this, and this, you have to walk this part out. You have to come willingly to the Lord. Okay, you have to take his yoke. When you're taking his yoke, you're taking his word and making it applicable to your everyday life and every area of your life. So you are coming in. So when the Bible says refuse, you refuse it. When the Bible says go, you go. Okay, so whatever the word is telling us to do, that's how we are yoking ourselves to Christ. We are doing what he says, and then we're continually learning. He will create lessons for us through our everyday life. Every day, if you examine your life at night, lay down. I mean, it's something that I've done for a while, but at night I just lay in my bed and go over my day to find out what is it that I have learned. Okay, whether it was through interaction with someone, whether it was reading the scripture, because life presents us lessons, all right? So learning of him, how did you see Jesus today? Where did you find him today? Okay, what was he doing today? Were you a part of that? So taking the yoke, When we take the yoke, and he promised that it would be easy. He promised, because he's there to help us, that it would be light. So whenever you're in a quandary in any area of your life, perhaps if you find an unrest or you find it burdensome, perhaps that's not what God has called you to. Okay? So you need to really learn from him. Lord, is this your way? What is it about this situation that is causing me such uneasiness? Because one thing God gives to his people is rest. We can forfeit it, but that's what he gives to us, rest. And so when you're dealing in evangelism, when you're out there laboring in the harvest, you're going to find people. This is a precious promise that we have. That if you give your life to the Lord, God is going to give you rest. And what seems to be a burden, he's going to carry that with you, or he invites you to cast it on him because he cares. So this little portion right here is an invitation that you can use to people that you meet in the harvest.
Which leads us to the top of page 99. The yoke of God is not simply imparted by him. It is shared by him. Mm-hmm. And I'm visual, so it made me think of slavery. Did the master share anything but heartache and grief and strife with the people? So God is not a slave master.
Mm-hmm.
He shares, he imparts, he leads, he guides. And the things he does, his yoke is easy. So, breaking the yoke. 99?
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah. Okay. 99, breaking the yoke.
Over there, I jumped ahead.
Okay, breaking the yoke. It is God's desire that every yoke of sin, self, and man in your life be broken. It is necessary if you are to fulfill the vision. And Pastor was saying about rest. You can't fulfill the vision if you're weighted down with the trials and tribulations of life. Mm-hmm. It's too weighty. That's why he said, take my yoke. Mm-hmm. You know, so I envision his yoke like your feet dangling in the air, because he has everything. You know, everything is on him. Yeah, so we're floating. Mm-hmm. And we can go through life in rest and peace.
In the Old Testament record, Israel was surrounded by the enemy army of the Assyrians. God spoke to Israel and declared, "The Lord of hosts has sworn, saying, surely as I have thought, so shall it come to pass, and as I have purposed, so shall it stand." I love the word of God. "That I will break the Assyrians in my land, and upon my mountains tread him underfoot. Mm-hmm. Then shall his yoke depart from off of them, and his burdens depart from off their shoulders." And God does the same thing for us. He'll take that yoke and just snatch it up. But we have to let it go. Sometimes we hanging on to the yoke.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. And we wonder why stuff ain't going the way we want it to go. And we over here, we want to preach, we want to minister, but we so weighted down over here. And we on both sides of the fence. But God wants to relieve us for that so we can fulfill the vision. God wanted to break the yoke from off the neck of Israel. But his purpose extended beyond Israel to the nations of the world. That's us. This is the purpose that is purposed upon the whole earth. And this is the hand that is stretched out upon all nations. What was God's purpose? Just read the rest of that, Ms. Trusilla.
His purpose was that the yoke of bondage be broken from the nations of the world.
God wants every yoke in your life to become as a dead corpse. He wants to destroy it in order to bring you under the yoke of him. So he wants you to take his yoke, just like he said in his word, because his yoke is easy and it is light. God wants every yoke in your life to become, and he wants to destroy it in order to bring you under the yoke of him. How will it be broken? Read that scripture for me. Are you with us? You following along with us? Okay. Miss LaVorn.
"And the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing." Isaiah 10:27.
Yeah.
"It will not be destroyed by deep teaching. It will not be destroyed by psychology or education. Mm-hmm. It will not be destroyed through counseling or through an organization or denomination. It will be destroyed by the anointing of the Holy Spirit, which is the power of God."
Can we just highlight that? That might go.
Yes, yes.
So what they're saying is my deep teaching here. It's not going.
Okay.
It's not going to break the yoke. I'm sorry, y'all. I tried,
but it's giving us the knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Maybe I come with some deep words, big words, and you know.
That definitely ain't gonna
help. Right.
"It will be destroyed by the anointing of the Holy Spirit, which is the power of God, not by man." Mm-hmm. "Not by us doing what we want to do, how we want to do it. Not by our deep teaching." Pastor, I love to hear you preach, but that's not going to do it. It is the anointing of the Holy Ghost.
Anointed preaching.
Yes.
Anointed teaching.
Yes.
Anointed singing.
Yes.
Anointed serving.
Yes.
When the Holy Spirit hits it,
yes,
then it's going to destroy people. You can have somebody singing,
yes,
and it just creates. It will break, and we have witnessed it. It will break up something. So preaching and teaching by itself, no. But the word is already anointed by itself. But you couple that, you yoke that with an anointed preacher, mm-hmm. or a teacher, or a singer, or a cleaner. Some of my best cleaning is when I'm listening to anointed music. Yeah. Okay, then it's going to destroy the yoke. So.
Oh yeah, I've had quite a few yokes destroyed. So by anointed with the word, anointed preaching, mm-hmm. teaching, it's courses that are being taught. When you go throughout this Lord. Course, I'm telling the people that's going to sit behind this desk, everyone is different, mm-hmm. but everyone fits the need.
Amen.
And
anointed.
Yes. Yes.
Anointed.
I'm just new out the gate, so y'all bear with me.
Great job.
All right, page 100. Results of breaking the yoke. God said, what did God say, Mr. John?
Is not this the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burden, and to let the oppressed go free, and that ye break every yoke.
Mm-hmm. And I like the response here as he go on. It says, then he listed the results of breaking the yoke. Then shall thou call, and the Lord shall answer.
Mm-hmm.
That's one. Thou mm-hmm. shalt cry. You say it with me, John. He shall say, here I am.
Mm-hmm.
Then shall thy light rise in obscurity. And thy darkness be as the noonday. Love the word of God. Mm-hmm. And the Lord shall guide thee continually, mm-hmm. and satisfy your soul in drought. That's like that inner way deep down stuff. Your soul in drought. And make fat thy bones. And thou shalt be like a watered garden, and like a spring of water whose waters fail not. Mm-hmm. The best water I ever had was out of a spring,
mm-hmm.
up the side of a road in Georgia. It was cold when it was 90 degrees, and it was cold when it was 2 degrees. Best water. So if that spring of water,
no.
If it's good in the natural, it's mm-hmm. it's phenomenal in the spiritual.
My God, sanctuary of living waters.
Well, you shall never thirst again.
Yeah. This is, did he get to the old waste places? You didn't get there yet, did you?
Mm-mm.
Okay, so I'm not going to go there yet. But look at verse 6. Okay, is not this the fast that I had chosen? So when God calls us to a fast, and I have to back you up to the first paragraph on that page. It says, but God's purpose for breaking the yoke extends beyond your life to the nations of the world. He wants to break the yoke of bondage in your life in order to enable you to fulfill the vision of breaking the yoke from the nations of the world around you. All right, you read the scripture, and this is the purpose that is purposed upon the whole earth. And this is the hand that stretched out upon all the nations. For the Lord hath purposed it, that all men be saved. That's his desire. That's what he purposed. Who shall disannul it? All right? And his hand is stretched out. Stretch out your hand. Okay. Who's able to push God's hand back? Nobody. I can move up at, but, you know, once God has purposed the thing, it's established.
Yes.
It is established. And so part of, and again, this is talking about by the time you finish, you will have gone back. This is like God showing us the vision. Okay, the vision is what it looks like. Now we got to go back to the beginning. So your next course is going to take you back and walk you step by step, so that the end result is your reaping.
Amen.
All right? Part of it is fasting. And we don't want to fast. Tuesday is our fast day, or the fast day of the intercessors here. Tuesday is the fast day, and about 1 o'clock, they started group, pray my strength, pray my, it was just one right after the other. They were, it was challenging that day. All of them were experiencing something. And so I sent a word to encourage them, and then I saw them say, because usually at 6 o'clock they can eat, they come here at 7 for prayer and Bible study. So then you start seeing, I'm not going to eat till after service, because if it's this intense, God must be going to do something in the service, because they were battling so much. He says, is not this the fast that I have chosen? What is the purpose of us fasting? And that's what we have to ask ourselves. Are we answering this question? Is it loosing the bands of wickedness? Is it undoing the heavy burdens? Are the oppressed being set free? And are yokes being broken or being destroyed? All right, so when they got, I wasn't here, but I kept getting the reports. It was two young ladies, one from Sunday, the one young lady that came up Sunday, and another one who had really been in a situation. And both of them just received the power of the Holy Ghost. Were you here?
No.
Tuesday night? They both received the baptism in the Holy Ghost, the power. And the young lady, even speaking to her yesterday for about an hour and a half, God is churning up some stuff in her life. Her first church experience was with a witch who was a pastor. That was her first experience. So she's got stuff embedded in her. But the power of Holy Spirit came to be her helper to deliver her. If they had not been fasting, if they had not pushed through, she might not have that Tuesday got her yoke. She's been coming. She's been hearing the word. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. She's been coming and hearing, but the fast pushed her. So it's not about us. Our going through the yoke, you know, our being released from yokes of bondage is so that somebody else can get it. They too can be set free. And then they shall be of thee. This is what God gave me when he called me to evangelism, this right here. And they that shall be of thee shall build the old waste places. Imagine, one can chase 1,000. Two can put 10,000 to flight. So I'm saved, I go and get you. We can do more together. So when this begins to multiply, when our vision, when we have taken hold of God's vision, and we're seeing like he, the more we have, the more we can get done. Mm-hmm. He says, and they that shall be of thee shall build the old waste places. Thou shalt raise up the foundations of many generations. This young lady, her parents sent her for psychological counseling. And the counselor told her, since you have been hurt in the church, maybe you don't need to go to church anymore. Her parents told her, we don't think you should be going to church because you don't seem to be able to get it together. But when the anointing comes to destroy that yoke, those will be raised up another generation. So here she is coming out of an unchurched environment, and I'm just using her for an example. An unchurched environment, she can, because your sister sent her here, okay? She now is able to bring a yoke-destroying power to her household. Mm-hmm. And what she said to me last night was, I'm going to see if my parents can come Sunday. I'm going to see if they will come to hear what I'm hearing. Okay, so we raise up many generations, and thou shalt be called, that's you, thou shalt be called the repairer of the breach and the restorer of paths to dwell in, because you are reconnecting people with their creator. You have a mandate on your life.
And it's not just sitting up in a church every week reporting for, it's not just reporting for attendance sake, but it's reporting so that you can be inspired and empowered to go back out into the harvest field. Not just to your job, you know, not just to your usual daily routine, but to look on the fields and see what's ripe, see what's ready to be reaped. Go ahead.
That was good. I'm starting to be a student myself.
That's my verse right there.
Now the results of breaking mm-hmm. of the yoke of bondage are,
Mimos, read the first one.
You will know the voice of God. We will call and the Lord mm-hmm. will answer. Here I am.
You will be successful in the fulfillment of your vision. Your light will rise in obscurity, which speaks of success. Mm-hmm.
Lord will guide you continually.
He will be your provision.
John. You will be reproductive.
You will be like a watered garden which is fruitful. You will be reproductive, and those you produce in the spirit will also be reproductive. In the spirit world will be productive. They will rise up to rebuild the old structures on the right foundation.
God promised Israel in the natural world, and the tree of the field shall yield her fruit, and the earth shall yield her increase, and they shall be safe in their land, and shall know that I am the Lord when I have broken mm-hmm. the bands of their yoke. The same is true in the spirit world. The breaking of the yoke results in spiritual productivity. The old network is inadequate, broken, and empty. It cannot accommodate the abundant harvest. The old yokes of tradition, denomination, self-effort, and unconcern must be broken. New foundations, new yokes, a new network are necessary to enter the gap between sinful man and a righteous God. We remember that? Mm-hmm. The vision will only be fulfilled by men and women who have experienced the anointing which was the yoke.
Anybody been an alcoholic? A drug addict? A whoremonger? A liar? A cheat? Or you were just born? We're all born in sin and shaped in iniquity. Okay, so now that you are saved, all right, those yokes have been broken off of us, so we know that there's a power that can break it off of anybody else's life. Okay, I'm gonna go over the self-test.
A couple. What are the three yokes of bondage?
Sin, self, and man. Mm-hmm.
All right. List the three words that describe the yoke of God.
Easy, love, and rest.
All right. Okay. What are the three steps you must take to bridge the gap between the yoke of bondage and the yoke of God?
Come, learn, and take.
All right, we're going to run through 10. We're going to run through it. Did everybody read 10? Mm-hmm. Okay, good. So we can run through. Identify spiritual qualities of Abraham, which enable him to bless the nation. Recognize you are an heir to the promises of Abraham, and understand your responsibility as an heir to bless the nations of the world. One of the things that I want you to remember, because I have said it in error and it became a habit, and we usually say we're spiritual Israel. The reality is we're the seed of Abraham.
Amen.
Okay? We are the seed of Abraham. We are heirs of the promises of Abraham. And that goes back before the law. That goes back even before the children were called out to be a nation. All right, so though we were grafted in, you know, the word talks about he came unto his own. In other words, just the same principle he teaches when we go into the harvest. Start at Jerusalem home, start, then go to your neighbor, you know, and then the one that's distant. All right, so he started in his home and they rejected him. But as many as received him, he gave the power to be called the sons of God. According to the order or according to what he promised Abraham. So we are Abraham's seed. Galatians 3:29. And if ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. So get that in your spirit. And as we, in fact, in the bachelor program, we're doing an intense study of the covenant of Abraham so that we'll know. So we'll, you'll get some of that. Okay, Genesis 22:18 is where he promised to Abraham that he would be the father of many nations, or that as a result of his seed, many nations would be blessed. The New Testament reveals that all believers are heirs to the promises God gave Abraham. And I encourage you in your own study time, you know, go get a concordance or something, or Google what were the promises made to Abraham, and then embrace them. What are the blessings that were attached to Abraham? You know, research those and claim them for yourselves because you're heirs with them. Galatians 3:7-9. Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, and the heathen represented those outside of the Jewish nation, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all the nations be blessed. So the promise came long before the Lord came and the other prophets and all spoke of it. It was given to Abraham in the beginning. All right, come over to 105. As seed of Abraham, right at the very top, as seed of Abraham, you are an heir of the promise of salvation. But as an heir, you are also under commission to bless the nations of the world with the good news of Christ. So you can't just claim houses and land and gold and silver, okay? You gotta also claim that you are blessed to be a blessing. And where are you gonna be a blessing? When you're reaching a lost, when you're reaching for the lost. Because that's the purpose in which he blessed Abraham. We're going back to the vision of God. You are told to claim your inheritance. Ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, and the uttermost parts of the earth for thy possession. So let's open ourselves up to go beyond our nationality. Okay, let's go beyond what we're familiar with. And let's read, because Jesus died for the whole world. And as Abraham, as the heirs of Abraham and the promise of Abraham, he has desired to give us an inheritance. You know, I started, my husband and I started the church in 2000. We had, you know, a lot of single mothers and all, but they were all African American. And then all of a sudden, a whole congregation from the Haitian American community or the Haitian community, and I'm like, why am I pastoring all these Haitians? Okay, but God was giving me the nation. I know a little bit of French because I took French. I hear the dialect, and I try to communicate the dialect with people who are in French. Those of you that have Spanish, my Lord Jesus, I couldn't get it. So let's go beyond. Let's study other cultures and all, so that we can claim them as an inheritance too. There are some white people that I have led to the Lord. Because one thing about when you become born again, you no longer know people after the flesh, but the spirit. So we've got to move up all these other barriers and blockers and begin to look at people as souls. Their souls, the soul of men. What are the spiritual qualities that Abraham possessed? One, he was fully persuaded. Okay, if God said it, he believed it, that settled it. All right, and so as God, you know, Romans 4 says, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. When God told him leave the country, he left. When God told him that he was going to be the father of many nations, and he was an old man and had no children, he believed God. All right, number two, he invested in spiritual things. And this, I want to read that bottom paragraph there. A land was promised which Abraham had not seen. It was promised to a son he did not have. Yet Abraham did not doubt God. He invested his life in the plan of God in order for the promise of God to be fulfilled in future generations. All right, so we've got to make an investment in spiritual things. We you know, I'm big right now on this investing in gold and silver, but it ain't like, you know what it is for me? It's the spiritual side of it. Because of what's happening within times. It's the spiritual side that I've made certain sacrifices. All right, so we've got to invest in spiritual things. And like Brother John and I and Sister Carol, some of y'all are right behind us. The older we get, we know we don't have time for no foolishness.
Absolutely.
We got to make sure that we put our time in, because payday is coming after a while. All right? He was obedient to the call. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for inheritance, he obeyed. And he went out not knowing whither he went. Hebrews 11:8. He didn't have to go spy out the land. God said, leave your folk, leave your kindred, and go to a place that I'm going to show you. So he packed up not knowing where he was going to end up. How many can God do that with you today? Okay, God say, I want you to go to Mississippi. Who is it? Mississippi, you know, or Canada, or wherever, Haiti. Okay, if God were to say, I want you to go, but as you get into this and as you really sell out, God may say, God told me that I was ready for Africa after going for a test. I never wanted to go to Africa. I was afraid to fly 2 hours. How am I going to go way over there? But God prepared me. He says, I'm going to take you to a place that you have not been. And Abraham obeyed. He was willing to stand alone. All right? Look unto Abraham, you father, and unto Sarah that bear you. For I called him alone, and I blessed him and increased him. This is what God is saying about Abraham. When he called him to go to another place, he didn't call his brothers. He called him. Many times your calling is going to separate you from those you love the most. It will separate you. Will you be obedient and go? Are you? Go ahead.
It wouldn't. But that doesn't apply to your husband or your spouse, does it?
God would not separate you from your spouse. It's both of you go. Okay? Because he's a God of order. He doesn't go against his word. So, you know, If you're, say, the spiritual, if you're the one, because my husband was not the pulpiteer, you know, he was in the back count money, made sure stuff was in order and kept me in check. That was his assignment. But if I said, honey, God wants us to go, we had to move from here to Palm Beach. And I had to go and tell them. That's where my next assignment of training was. But God used a health incident with my aunt to move us. Okay? So when I told him, and I had to have the wisdom of God to tell him to leave Fort Lauderdale if it was just for a season. Okay, God will never ask you to do something. Remember, his burden, his yoke is easy, his burden is light, and you will find rest for your soul. So if it's confusion, it ain't God. Okay, yes. Now your children's another story.
Can I add to that? Can I add to
that? Go ahead.
There's a scripture in the Old Testament. I can't remember if it's Numbers. I think it's Numbers chapter 11 or something like that, where God gives specific instructions for order.
Mm-hmm.
So just to confirm or to agree or to add to what Pastor is saying, he gives us instructions for order. And in that order, if you're in a house and you're staying with your parent, there's order.
That's
and
right.
if you're in a marriage with a spouse, there's order. God is not the author of confusion to the point that he structured it where if you are the spirit-filled one, but because he's head of the house, and if you informed him as head of the house and he refused, now the weight is no longer on you, it's on him. Rather he know or he don't know, it's on him. And when God ready, God will enlighten him.
Mm-hmm.
But now it's no longer on you. You no longer have the guilt where you can say, well, God, you told me to do something. I didn't obey. He won't hold it against you because he know he's the head.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's all in numbers. And I just wanted to just share that.
Mm-hmm. Your order is everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the things that I have been in a lot of meditation and study about lately is that very word, order.
Mm-hmm.
And it's everywhere. Everywhere you go, you know, everything he created, remember, it was disorder and chaos. The earth was without void. The earth was dark and it was without void. And in other words, it was chaotic. There was no order to it. And he says, let there be light. So he brought order. He brought order. And so there's God. You have to recognize order everywhere. Everywhere, on your job, everywhere. All right, he was willing to stand alone. He had spiritual vision. He looked for a city which had foundations whose builder and maker was God. All right, so the bottom of that, the vision of the harvest has changed your life. You will never again be the same after this lesson, and it's a truth. You cannot be content with the temporal things of life. You seek an eternal cause. All right, so Abraham was constantly on the move. But God gave him a land of inheritance that he himself didn't put his feet on. He never went, he never got there, but his seed took possession of it. And all that conflict over in the Middle East is based on the promise God gave Abraham. All right, he knew God intimately, that he was called a friend of God. And because he believed God, it says, it was counted to him for righteousness. That's powerful. Because a lot of times we get caught up in works when it's faith. Because Abraham messed up a couple of times. Number 7, he was full of hope. This has to do with him conceiving. Who against hope believed in hope that he might become the father of many nations according to that which was spoken. So shall thy seed be. That's the word that God gave to Abraham. So shall thy seed be. Abraham didn't have no children. But he believed the word. He was hopeful concerning that word. What has God spoken unto you? He had strong faith. Abraham staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. Romans 4:20. The greatness of the vision to which God has called you is overwhelming. 3 billion people without the gospel message, these are heathen, but they are your inheritance. Through you, they are to be blessed. But do not stagger at the promise of God. Do not look to the greatness of the task before you, but look to the greatness of God. God has promised abundant spiritual harvest, so we want to be like him who believed God even though such as promise just couldn't come to pass in the Living Version. You like Abraham, you have to trust that if God has called you to a task, to a role, to a work, to a ministry, to start something new, that it's got to be outside of you because God called you. Mm-hmm. And it's going to cause you to exercise faith in order to accomplish it. Okay, Brother John, you can accomplish this by faith. Okay. It's by faith. 9, he was righteous because he believed God. So we talked earlier about the yokes, you know, taking the word of God. If you believe God's word says what it says and mean what it means, then how come we don't act upon it? But because he acted, he believed and acted upon God's word, he was accounted righteous. He was humble. Paul states that Abraham gave glory to God. Abraham knew the fulfillment of the vision would only come through God. He alone must receive the glory. God has given you a great vision in the harvest fields of the nations of the world, but the fulfillment can only come through him. You cannot receive glory for the vision or for results of the harvest. The glory must go to God for a vision fulfilled. Where do we get the vision? God. It's from God. Okay, so what he does is he just empowers and enables us to fulfill it. And even watch out for false pride. Watch out when God uses us in a capacity. Watch out for, you know, that pride rising up, because he was the very opposite. He was humble. He recognized the source of everything that we're called to do, the accomplishment, the success of anything we're called to do is only by the power of God. He was peaceful. In Genesis 13, the servants of Lot and Abraham had disagreement over water rights. Abraham arrived at a peaceful solution. So this goes back to the spiritual qualities that he had, which enable him. These qualities should be in us. He was peaceful. Number 12, he was prompt to do God's will. I love this piece here. When God spoke to Abraham that the sign of the covenant between him and God was to be circumcision, the Bible records that the same day God spoke, Abraham had all the men in his family circumcised. So when God gave him a word to do something, he didn't hesitate, didn't procrastinate. And that's what we have to do. Okay, the next page. In Isaac, second paragraph, in Isaac was the future of the promise of God. He was the heir through whom Abraham's descendants were to come. Isaac was to bring forth the nation of Israel through which the world was to be blessed. Yet, God asked Abraham to offer his son as a sacrifice. Somebody read that next paragraph.
The Bible records, sorry, go ahead. No, go ahead.
The Bible records in Genesis 22:3 that after Abraham received the message from God, he rose up early in the morning to obey the instruction.
Mm-hmm.
Even when God's will was difficult, Abraham did not delay. When God spoke, he acted immediately. Because of his obedience, God provided another sacrifice, and Isaac's life was spared.
How many times we delay in our disobedience, and we perhaps miss out on a phenomenal blessing because of our delay in obedience. Okay, read the next two paragraphs.
Labor in the harvest field will not always be easy, but when God speaks, you must act. When you step forward in obedience, God will always move in your behalf. It is interesting to note that Abraham never referred to God's instructions regarding Isaac as a sacrifice. He called it worship. The highest form of worship is to look beyond Isaac, that which we love, to God.
My God, that was powerful. I had to post that today. Because that statement right there, that's powerful. It's powerful. God said sacrifice, and Abraham said, me and the land are going to worship. God said sacrifice. and because he was righteous and humble, and you know, he had his ear, he knew God, he learned God, he believed God, he says, and imagine, the Bible talks about a book called, isn't it written in the book of, it's not Jabez, but there's another book that didn't make it into the Bible.
Enoch?
No. And it gives a very detailed history of Abraham and his family and all. And more so how he left. It's written in the scripture. The scripture makes reference to it. So there is, you know, a book. It's somebody else's story or his story about it. You know, but how he didn't even say to Sarah what God told him. Because he had the confidence that he was just willing. He raised the knife. He raised the knife. And God knew that he had Abraham's heart. What can God trust us with? This just, you know, went back to me today, okay? In a transition. What can I trust God with? I trust him with all my life. Okay. 13, he was mobile. Abraham lived a simple life, which enabled him to completely be mobile, or whatever God wanted him to do, he could do it. The Bible says he was rich in gold, in silver, in cattle, in, you know, workmen. He was rich, but yet he was mobile. He could be moved at any time. Okay, he walked in revelation knowledge. He didn't act upon human reasoning. And so God revealed things to him. He did not look to his natural abilities. Okay, he sought God. Genesis 12 records how Abraham built an altar and called on the name of the Lord. And this is what should be in us. He assumed responsibility for others. We see that in the story of Abraham and Lot. And it says here, if you're going to be a world Christian, then you must assume responsibilities for those in need in the world around you. Okay, whatever that may be. He was generous. God blessed him. And blessed be the Most High God, which hath delivered thine enemies into thy hand. And he gave him tithes of all. So he was blessed. He was a giver. He was generous.
Did he pay tithes to Melchizedek?
Yes, who was a type of Christ. Okay, and there's one scripture. Yeah, Melchizedek was a king, but he was a type of Christ.
No mother, no father, no beginning.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Right. And so as a result, so when people have the debates, well, tithes of the Old Testament and all that, tithe was before law. It was before the law was given. And so in the New Testament, when it deals with giving and our priesthood and all of that, it refers to the order of Melchizedek. All right, and so we tithe under that order. That's the order we tithe under, not under the Jewish law. We tithe under the order of Melchizedek. He was willing to dwell. Okay, he was willing to dwell in a strange land. This is good. By faith, he sojourned in the land of promise as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. In other words, he was willing to respect the culture of others. For example, he bowed before the people of the land as was the custom. So in our going out, in our evangelism and all, we don't want to usurp ourselves. You know, well, this is me, this is how I do it, you know, on and on. No, you want to give honor, reverence to who it's due without bowing to idols. You're just observing other people's customs. The Bible says if me eating meat offends you and we're all going out to dinner, then I'm not going to eat meat. I won't die and I certainly won't be an offense. So Abraham was no offense, but he honored the people that he was around. He reproduced men of like dedication. This is seen of the life of his servant Eleazar. He gave the glory to God. And, you know, again, after a great battle and a great victory, every time they got a victory, he was increased in riches because of the spoils. So anytime you are going through a rough patch in life or a rough test, you know, or you're in a spiritual battle, just know when you come out of that battle, you're coming out with some spoil. Something good is going to come out of it. Because the word says all things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. Okay, so always remember that the glory belongs to God. The vision fulfilled. Abraham, a man with a spiritual vision. He was a man through whom the nations of the world were to be blessed. And the vision was fulfilled. Therefore, from one man, Abraham, and him as good as dead. In other words, he was in the place where he was what? 90? And hadn't had no children? Or 70? Okay. And hadn't had no children. Were born as many as the stars of the sky in multitude, innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. When the vision was given to Abraham, his past had been unproductive and his present was unproductive. But he did not accept the deadness of his own body or of Sarah's womb. Perhaps your past has been spiritually unproductive and your present is unfruitful, but now you have received a vision of the harvest. As Abraham looked with the eyes of faith into the future, knowing that he who has promised is also able to perform it. And that's what we have. Okay, we're going to go on into 11. Go ahead, Adrian.
Does anyone need to break or
look
to the restroom? Okay, chapter 11. The vision becomes reality.
Let us read the first four, the key verse. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. So it's worth it. Stay the course. Stay the course. When we started this course, you began an experience which would lead from vision to reality. From the birth of the vision of the harvest, you have seen the world through the eyes of God and understand his purpose for the nations of the world. You have learned of things which prevent harvest and the strategies, methods, and tools for effective harvest. You have broken the yokes of bondage and tradition and received a new experience of God's power. In this final chapter, the vision becomes reality as you become part of its fulfillment. So I'm going to hit a couple of things. Okay, so I'm just going to hit a couple of things. Who does God use?
People?
Absolutely. Use men. Use men. Meaning male, female. I mean men overall in general. On page 117, it says, how could he possibly, and he's talking about the disciples, leave the future of the disciples in the hands of these disciples? This is why. Because he was not looking at them as they were. Mm-hmm. God is not looking at you the way you are, thank God. Mm-hmm. He never used me. He was not looking at their past performance or their present condition. He was seeing them as they would become when endued by the power of the Holy Spirit. Because mm-hmm. he knows what his power in yes. you will do. He needs a willing vessel. And if we allow him to use us, we can do great and mighty things, but only through the Holy Spirit. God is not looking at your past, your failures, your doubts, or unbelief. He is looking at what he knows you can become through, there again, the power of the Holy Spirit. Because if we look at the history of the men that he used in the Bible, I put a little list here. We're just going to, Jacob, deceiver, Abraham,
liar,
mm-hmm. Moses, disobedient, David, murderer, Gideon, scary. That's what we use. You know, if you read throughout the Bible, you're like, okay, God used some jacked up people to turn this world upside down. The 12 disciples, they all had their own personalities. He had to deal with 12 grown men and all the personalities that they had. Each one of them probably had 12 personalities. And he dealt with that. But those very 11, exception one, is why we're standing here today. Because they stayed the course, they allowed the Holy Spirit to endow them, to equip them, to teach them. And they didn't keep it to themselves. They went through hell and high water to get this word out. Living in caves, like we said, in dungeons, and they had the power of God. God uses ordinary people. He uses ordinary people to fulfill his will. When Jesus performed his first miracle of turning water into wine, he asked ordinary men to fill the water pots. When he multiplied bread and fish, he gave it to ordinary men who then fed the multitude. When Jesus was about to perform what was perhaps the greatest miracle in his ministry, that of raising Lazarus from the dead, he depended on men to remove the stone from the entrance of the grave. Didn't the same God who raised Lazarus have the power to remove the stone of the entrance? Clearly. Yes, but God has always used men to fulfill his plan, and that hasn't stopped today. His methods are men. God calls ordinary men and makes them extraordinary. I like that. He makes ordinary men extraordinary. He moves men and women from spectators to participators. So, because you signed up for this class, you are no longer spectators. You are participators in this walk. So we have a job to do. So your pew ministry has ended.
Amen.
He moves men and women from spectators to participators in his plan. All you ordinary people who thought you couldn't be used of God, you ordinary people who thought you couldn't be part of a miracle, all who have denied and failed, God is not looking at your past or your present performance. He is now, he is not seeing you as you view yourself. Thank God. Because, you know, I can't speak for men, but I think you all are a little bit better than us. But they did a survey on how women see themselves. I saw one where they had women to come into a room, and based on what they told the painter of themselves, they painted the picture. But they didn't see the picture. So when they came back, when all of them came back, all these pictures were sad and just, because we see ourselves so ugly. God doesn't care about that. He doesn't see that. And a lot of times we don't have confidence to do things. And God is like, I don't see all of that. I can use a rock. I can use a donkey. He can use us, and he's going to use us. He is using us. And this is just the first step. Oh, where was I? You're supposed to keep me on task here. He is looking at you as you will become, as you accept the challenge to go to the harvest fields of the world. Like I said, he willing vessels. He is seeing you as you will be when endowed with power of the Holy Ghost. God is not depending on your faith, your education, your talents, your level of spirituality. He is not depending on anything that you are. He is depending on what he knows you can become if you will surrender your life totally to his will and purpose.
Mm-hmm. That's important.
Yes, it is. You have to be willing, and you have to surrender all your members. And that reminds me of swimming. How many of you can swim? Let me say that again. How many of you can float?
I can float.
That's a good one. That's a real good one.
In order to float, you have to relax every muscle in your body. Every muscle. And the thing is, when you float on your back, the water, you would think the water would come here, and you know, but the water comes right around your eyes. Right around your mouth, just under here. That's, you got to trust that you know how to float. And that's what God said. You have to surrender everything for me. And sometimes I feel like you just may have that straw out of the water to breathe when God asks us stuff. But we have to trust him. Just like Abraham trusted him with his son, we have to trust him. And we do that when we pray.
And that part there, and I'm speaking from a leadership capacity, when new people come into the church, especially here, I don't have them sitting for long periods of time to make themselves. If they come in and they're ready and they're available, if they make themselves available, I try to meet with everybody and just go over, you know, their skills and all. Not that that matters, but to see what their heart beats for. Okay, and then try to move them in that place. And I tell everybody, if there's not a place that you fit, we'll create a place, you know, of something. We'll create a ministry of something that you like to do. Why? Jesus taught his disciples on the job. They didn't go to school. They didn't wait. He taught them on the job. And even when they didn't get the lesson, you know, he fussed at them. When he had told them about his death and his resurrection and all of that, and they didn't believe him, he fussed at them.
you know, I told you all this, how long am I going to be with you or what have you, but because God sees more in you than you see in yourself, okay, every now and then he will allow those he uses to train and to mentor you see beyond where you are as well. All right. So are there others that say, well, I wouldn't put them up there. They're too young. That thing goes on in the church. You know, the Bible says now that a novice shouldn't be there leading. That's different than being put in a place or a position where they can do ministry.
And to give I have a personal example of what she just said. I was new to the church again, and she sent me this text. I'm relaxing in my bed, and I'm chilling. Beautiful Saturday, or whatever day it was. And she texts me and asked me, would I be her armor bearer? I looked at that phone. I was like, uh-uh. I called my best friend. I said, girl, let me tell you what.
See, guess who she called? Instead of saying, God, she didn't do an Abraham, okay?
I was new to the church. I hadn't gotten that spiritual built up yet. So I called my best friend, and I'm like, girl, this pastor just asked me, I'm reading her text, would I be her armor bearer? I'm like, I don't even know what armor bearer is. She said, I asked her, what is an armor bearer? And she tried to explain. I'm like, what? Do what? That isn't that what the deacons or the, you know, where I come from, the deacons and the deaconess and all, you know, they did that. So we had a picnic, and she had me to sit in front of her, and she's telling me, okay, you know, I want you to be my armor bearer, this, that, and the other. And I'm just looking at her like, I asked her, are you sure? And she was like, yeah, you know, I said, well, I don't know anything about it. She's like, she has a book for everything. I have a book. I'll give you a book. And I must have asked her 3 times. Are you sure? And she was like, yes, you know, God shined the light. God showed her. I was like, God will use anything, y'all. I'm telling you. For me to be an overbearer, my friends looked at me like, you?
Good.
And one... And it must have worked out pretty good because my friend stopped us one time in Boston Market, and she said, I just want to say thank you. Thank you. You have changed her. So God can use anything. Yeah. Anybody. Mm-hmm. Just willing. And I booked behind the scenes. You don't know I booked, but.
Yes, I do.
I bumped a little bit, you know. The other armor bearer, she, you know, she was trying to teach me, and I was like, I don't want to do this. I didn't say it like that. I said, no, I don't want to talk to her. I don't want to go up there. She was like, you have to. I was like, no, I want to do it. But God is good. We have evolved. Now she probably wish I'd go sit down somewhere. But anyway, don't say nothing. Don't say nothing. The world of the early church was not reached through great preaching. It was reached by men and women who were as human as we are, but they turned their eyes from their own failures and caught the vision of the harvest. They realized that when they were weak in the natural, they were strong spiritually. Because God promised, it's one of my favorites, my grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in your weakness. Mm-hmm. I love that scripture. That keeps me. Mm-hmm. It keeps me when, I mean, day in and day out. So God would use anybody that's willing. And that will, in being willing, you have to surrender all to your, to God. An abundant harvest. 2 more minutes and I'm done. To those who catch the vision and fulfill the work and will of God, there are promises of an abundant harvest. Can you read that verse for me, Janice, right? Mm-hmm. On the an abundant harvest.
For the seed shall be prosperous, the vine shall give her fruit,
and the ground shall give her increase, and the heavens shall give them their due. Zechariah 8 and 12. He will turn the wilderness mm-hmm. into fertile fields. He turneth the wilderness into a standing water, and dry ground into water springs. And there he maketh the hungry to dwell, that they may sow the fields and plant the vineyards, which may yield fruits of increase. Psalms 107. 35 and 37.
God will even bring harvest to the least fruitful places. Mm-hmm. Those people who you think you can't give a word to mm-hmm. or share the word with, those are the main ones. Mm-hmm. You know, we may see somebody full of tattoos. Mm-hmm. And you know, I had to talk to my godson yesterday. You know, his grandfather's blasting him like, "Oh, I'm so disappointed in you. You did." And he's a great young man, never been to jail. He works, he helps his family, but he has tattoos. He's tatted up, you know, he grew up in a little neighborhood and he's still hanging with them, but he's a good kid. So we can't dismiss people because of that, you know, their outward appearances. God can make a rose come up out of the desert. So we can't judge things because God is able. Age is no barrier to his plan. You know, you can be 70 years old and just realizing the vision of God. Mm-hmm. But he will use you too. You may go forth weeping and travail to birth this vision. Mm. But they that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weepeth bearing precious seeds shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves in. You cannot comprehend the abundance of this end time harvest. I'm sorry. God speaks of harvest so great that it is continuous. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that the plowman shall overtake the reaper and the treader of grapes and him that soweth seed. You will not even finish threshing out the harvest until the next harvest is upon you. When I read that, I was like, whoa. It's like you gathering in the harvest, you out there, you're reaping it. Before you finish that field, this field is ready, and that field is ready. It's there. It's the harvest is ready. It's ready. We have to go out there and reap. We got to go get it.
And in the church, what that looks like in the church is you may have a group, you know, of people that come in for a season and they're learned, they're trained, you know, they begin to grow in Christ, and then they go, and before they can get out the door, you got to start all over again. That's what that's about, and that's what it should be. All right, it's time out for carousing people in a building. Mm-hmm. And they just sitting there mm-hmm. year after year after year, and there's minimal growth. Mm-hmm. Okay, if each one reach one, we're double. And then if the double amount, if each one reaches one, okay, we have doubled ourselves again. The problem is we're stuck and we're not reaching beyond the walls. So that is what the whole essence of this Bible college is about. It is to stir up men and women from the pew so that they can go into the harvest field and reap. Who is going to give the reward? God is. Okay. Who is going to plant? Because everybody is not planted at Sanctuary. We've got about 4 different churches represented here. That's God's business, where he plants them. But we are all harvesters. We should all be out there harvesting or reaping the harvest, because it's there. You cannot escape the harvest. It's there.
And what I love about it is who God sends you to harvest. You know, you may harvest young girls. You know, you may harvest older women. You may harvest
middle-aged women. You know, you may harvest children. You may harvest men, older men. Mm-hmm. You know, it's so much out there. You know, you have black-eyed peas and string beans and collard greens and mustard greens and almost like Shirley mm-hmm. Caesars. You know. So it's so much out there, you know. And one group that a lot of people, I won't say, tend to shy away from, that's the young people. Because they are, you like them, don't you? Because mm-hmm. they look a little.
They love me too. Yeah.
They look a little, you know, because they're so, I look at them sometimes. Man, they just look, you know, it's like what is happening to our young generation? And a lot of older people want to stay away from them. You know, you got the pants down to here. And the hair all over the place, and tattoos, and the girls with eyelashes out to here. And,
because they don't have vision. The reason that they stay away is because they don't have vision.
And those are the ones that when you get to them, oh my God, they are gentle souls. You know, so we can't look at the outside. This is why we need for laborers. The need for laborers is so urgent. The plowman is overtaking the reaper. The vision of the harvest is before you, just like Pastor just said. Claim the promise of abundant harvest. Claim the heathen of your inheritance. Mm-hmm. The fields of the world are before you. Lift up your eyes and look. Mm-hmm. They are there. Like she said, she liked the young people. I like them too. I do. I like them too. But they're out there. Babies, old, young. All different colors, they're there, and they need to, Pastor said about, you know, go outside your nationality. You know, we don't always have to minister to, if we continue to minister to the same people, we're on a wheel, a hamster wheel, going around in circles, and yet people all around us are hurting and need Jesus. Oh, man, and this is the perfect time, because we really need Jesus in this day. The final harvest. There will come that day of final harvest when God commands his angels, the time has come for thee to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. Revelation 14:15. Now I'll tell you what harvest means in Revelation. From all over this world, the procession will come. From Africa, Australia, Asia, North and South America, Europe, the islands of the sea. See, harvest is streaming into the throne of God. Men and women who have made the vision a reality. Those who live with the vision as central to their reason of being. We have to have a hunger and a thirst for this vision. Those who died embracing his promises. And they bring with them the sheaves from the harvest of the earth. Ms. Lahorne, can you read that last chapter?
After this, I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number of all nations, and kindreds, and people and tongues stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. And cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sits upon the throne, and unto the Lamb, and fell before the throne on their faces, and worshiped God, saying, amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. Amen. Revelation 7:9.
After this I beheld, and lo, a great nation, a great multitude, which no man could number of all nations, kindreds, people, and tongues stood before the throne. Of that nation, will there be people that you minister to, that you shared the gospel? I want to be a part of that multitude. I want to be a part of making that multitude happen. But we have to move out of ourselves and move into God and let him lead us, guide us, minister to us. Let us be a willing vessel so we can go out there, see the world how he sees it, and be a part of this great multitude. So imagine being up there and seeing so many people that didn't make it into that multitude. I don't want to feel guilty, no tight way. Lord, my crew made it. You know, so God bless everyone. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for
trusting me to sit side by side with her. Thank you all for coming each week, and I'm honored to stand before you. I'm honored to work with this lady that's near and dear to me, and I just look forward to what's going to become of each and every one of you all. So God bless you all, and thank you.
You're welcome.
And we might see you later in the course. If somebody's got a calendar, we may be on there later on in the course. All right, I'm gonna pull up on the computer the site. Brother John told me he had difficulty. Did you ever get it?
I did get through. What I had done, I had all the space in my name. But the problem was after I did the test, then it said 80 and then it said zero. So I don't know if I wiped it out accidentally.
I'll check it out. Anybody else try? So you got an 80?
I think so.
You did the midterm?
Yeah.
Okay. So the final is there. Okay. You want to keep with your 80?
Well, yeah.
Okay. Because I can reset it, but you would lose the first one.
Well.
You good with the 80? That's a B.
Oh, okay. I'll go with that.
All right, you still okay, have so the end of it. I just
have
want
to be completed by the third
class. Before the next class starts, so by Saturday. Okay, you have.
Yeah. Saturday midnight.
Because this is an extra.
This Saturday?
Yeah.
Saturday midnight, right?
Definitely before next week's class. Okay, have it done, because usually you have that week in between, but because y'all wanted to come back, this is your week in between. So before the next class, if you don't do it, I will send you a little.
Now, what if I, okay, I know I talked to you already. Now, what if I tried it and I don't make an 80? What happened?
Have you started reading? Have you gone back to the beginning? Okay. So take the next couple of days and do the reading. This is probably your easiest test. If you try it and you don't make it, call me and I'll reset it. But you need to do the reading. You do the reading.
Self-test?
The self-test. Go over your self-test. Yeah. There are, I'm going to tell you now. There is one. Just one. There is one question that's going to ask about a scripture, and this is the question.
Multiplication.
All of it is multiple choice and true and false. Okay? Mm-hmm. This one question, what scripture reveals God's method of multiplication?
That's the hardest.
Ephesians ain't on here. But it gives you choices. This is your key, method of multiplication. So go in that chapter and look at those verses. There's only 53 questions. The last two questions, I completed the reading for the text, don't lie. And I completed the self-test at the end of the chapter. Those are the last two questions. I take it back. Deuteronomy 28, the question is, does Deuteronomy 28 illustrate the if-but principle? So you got to go back to where we talked about the if-but. Who tried to bring forth the vision through Ishmael? Brother John.
Abraham.
Okay, very good. Who said I was disobedient unto the heavenly vision?
Abraham.
Okay, well, y'all don't know. So it's Paul, Gehazi, or God?
Paul.
Okay. There are armies around us. What shall we do? Okay. And shall I bring to
Gehazi?
And shall I bring to the birth and not cause to bring forth? Who said that?
God.
Okay.
It's easy once you bring it to you see the
yeah.
you have.
Who's the mediator between God and man?
Jesus.
Okay. Multiple choice. Two principles of the spiritual foundation based on Jesus Christ are: one, redeemed men living redeemed lives; two, Mother Mary and Saint Peter; three, redeemed men living unredeemed lives.
Redeemed men living redeemed
lives.
You sound like it's self.
We went over a lot in class, so.
What are the three spiritual yokes of bondage we talked about tonight?
Sin, self, and man.
Okay. What is the main tool of spiritual harvest?
Water.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Kinda. But you shall receive.
That's it. Oh.
That's it. Okay. Let me do a true, a couple of true or false. Closed countries. You had to be here at the beginning. Closed countries cannot be reached with the gospel.
False.
Okay. The main enemies to the spread of the gospel are political powers.
Yes, that's true.
No.
Okay. I ain't telling because y'all divided. I'm not telling because y'all are divided. So you want to make sure you cover, just go again, go through your text. That would be,
Pretty much.
Satan has no interest in spiritual harvest.
Okay.
If your spiritual harvest is poor, there is no way you can change it.
Okay.
All right, y'all will be fine. Go through your self-tests. So you have until the end of the week. Let me give this to you. Okay. So it'll be your first name, last name, with no space in between.
Okay.
This is the password.
Okay.
Okay. And if you have any problems. And how many of you are going to be ready to start next Thursday for the new class, Foundations of Faith?
I should be.
Okay. Did you put a... Do y'all have your, did you give me last week?
Yes, ma'am.
Those registration forms for this class?
No, I don't think we got those registration forms for that class. I thought a registration form was one time registration.
Well, it's enrollment.
Oh. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Did you get one last week? Okay. Janice, what you gonna do? Yes.
Quick question.
Mm-hmm.
You checked this off for me.
you put a question mark, mm-hmm. but it told me to take the numbers and connect them to the ones that
right.
are
right. Okay, so did. Number one, right before, okay, the time during which the vision grows within you spiritually is development.
That's one.
Okay. The start of the vision in your spirit, conception. Okay. Okay, what's this? Right before the birth, the most difficult time when you must cease natural effort and let God bring forth vision. Mm-hmm. Is that travail or transition?
I had to go back and look because I confused them too, but that's travail.
You have started to go ahead, me too.
Travail is number four.
That's what I said, but when I look back in the book.
No, ma'am.